It's Commander Ron Saunier, S-A-U-N-I-E-R, Major Crimes. So we'll go ahead and get started. Wanted to just give you kind of a brief update and wrap up into the investigation that occurred at the National Western Complex, the motorcycle swap meet that occurred January 30th, 2016 at approximately 12:48 p.m. So, like, we've gone through a lot of the details, previous stuff, but upon arrival, officers located four gunshot victims that were transported to local hospitals. Three of them were in critical condition, one in serious condition. One of those that was in critical condition was pronounced at Denver Health Hospital by Dr. Shepard at 13 or 1:27 p.m. That was Mr. Mendoza. The scene was secured as best as we could there and then processed with witnesses being transported to headquarters. We have been involved in a very active ongoing investigation since that time to include hundreds and hundreds of hours by the detectives, crime lab, and everybody else involved in this case. Bottom line, detectives learned that there was a confrontation. Normally I don't go into kind of the stuff, but I'm just going to go ahead and use the two groups being they're out there very well in the media and such. So confrontation between the Iron Order and the Mongols on a stairway in the complex. The original confrontation turned into a physical fight, and at one point, Mr. Duran wound up pulling out a gun. That gun had very little influence towards the deal. Several comments were made, according to witnesses and according to Mr. Duran himself. He believed at that point, by what he's telling us, that he was in danger and fear for his life. He was in fear for the life of other individuals that were being assaulted. He fired one round, with one party being struck at that point in time. Mr. Duran then went up towards the top of the stairs where they all kind of waited up there. Their group was separated. He believed they wanted to try to get their group together. We do have, based on video evidence and stuff, you know, a lot of things corroborating what we had from the witnesses. So at the top of the stairs, Mr. Duran talks about being up there. Mr. Mendoza comes through the line of group, has a gun in his hand. He fires one time. That round wound up grazing Mr. Duran's side and then entering another individual, and that bullet remains in that individual. Mr. Duran then fired a shot back at Mr. Mendoza, striking him. At that point, the groups kind of took off to various locations seeking first aid for their help. Like I said, we have a lot of evidence that was found at the scene that was processed. We have video surveillance from the complex that was taken. We have other video that was obtained throughout the event that we looked at. Bottom line, we had upwards of the mid-40s in witnesses that we talked to in this case, either at the scene, brought down here for video interviews, or did phone interviews if they weren't there. Of those 40-plus witnesses, at least 17 of them were with the Iron Order that were there that day. Each and every one of them came down here. Mr. Duran, want to make it very clear that this has been a homicide investigation throughout. We have not considered this to be an officer-involved incident at all. Early on in the investigation, we looked up the state statute that is required, and Mr. Duran's color of authority is only applicable when he is at his facility that he is working. He is not a Class 1 peace officer, nor did Mr. Duran any time during this incident claim that he was taking action under his color of authority. So this has been a homicide investigation from the onset of that. Of the Iron Order, because this question has come up, none of the ones that came down or that we knew that were identified to us were working in law enforcement capacity at the time of this event. I believe there may have been some of them or one or two of them that had previous law enforcement, but none other than Duran had any active law enforcement employment at the time of the event. Like I said, we had approximately 30 independent witnesses that we talked to above and beyond the initial iron order that came down and gave us statements throughout, kind of afterwards. I believe that we have done a complete and thorough investigation into this based on talking to all the witnesses, based on looking at video evidence that we obtained from parties that were videotaping to surveillance and everything else. So everything kind of comes together and corroborates what everybody has to say. One of the victims was with the Mongols that did suffer. It was in critical condition. When we did talk to him to try to get more information from him, he chose not to talk to us or cooperate with the investigation as it went on. So, like I said, we kind of worked through that. We had 20-plus 911 callers that called 911 during this event, and we have tried to reach out and contact each and every one of those. Some were more willing than others. Others, you know, gave what they did. So I made the comment during the early stuff, we needed people to come forward. And bottom line, I think we have a real good idea of what happened. We did present this to the district attorney yesterday, and it is presented as we do in all homicide cases. We're going to present it looking at the most serious charge that's possibly out there, which in the state of Colorado is going to be first-degree murder, and it's that to include everything lesser to go down the event or down the lines. So it was presented kind of in that manner, looking at all of the facts, with the district attorney, and we don't make this determination, it's going to be up to them. But in the state of Colorado, homicide, or to a lot of crimes, which is self-defense. So it is up to the defendant to bring up this affirmative defense. It is then up to the district attorney's office to disprove that self-defense to a jury of 12 beyond a reasonable doubt. And that, based on what the district attorney's talk to us about, they do not believe that they are able to proceed forward. Any questions related to that, I would have to kind of refer to them on this. There's definitely, throughout the investigation, self-defense was brought up by multiple people, other witnesses that kind of corroborated what was going on. There was an allegation, I know, that the attorney for the Mongols brought up about Mr. Duran's intoxication level. Go ahead and address that right off the bat. We had detectives that were at the hospital very early on in this case, within probably an hour or two, that had contact with Mr. Duran. The officers at scene, no one at any time, i.e., you know, smelling a heavy odor of alcohol, bloodshot, watery eyes, his gait. Actual time later, we did not see any indication of intoxication. We would have to prove that beyond a reasonable doubt, too. So that item was addressed to the best that we could through the investigation. So that being said, I guess I can open it up for any questions. Yes, sir. Full hit. We do have evidence that shows possibly, it's hard to say because we do have in one of the guns that was recovered evidence of a misfire, which matches what witnesses told us they saw. So there could have been another round fired. The gun malfunctioned. It functioned when tested here. But what bottom line, what comes down, and this, trust me, is very, I guess, frustrating in my job a lot of times when we come on these scenes where someone has been murdered, a life's been taken, and because of the way the state of Colorado and the self-defense law, we have to overcome, or the district attorneys have to overcome, that affirmative defense. And there are some things in there about mutual combat and some of that. I would, you know, recommend that you reach out to the jury instructions. We did meet with the wife yesterday and her two attorneys down here as more of a courtesy to let them know where we're going so that they're not, you know, reading it on in the paper or seeing it firsthand there. We did, I know the detective, and they had the same conversations with him. Just to let them know. And those are never fun meetings. members over that, because they're bringing the same questions up.
It's a question of justice, isn't it?
Yes. Said I'd have to, I guess, refer you more towards the DA's office on, you know, their standards and stuff.
Mr. Duran was seen at the stock show pavilion there with handcuffs on immediately following the shooting. I'm wondering why that was and what you would say to those who may say the Iron Order has been associated with law enforcement and Mr. Duran himself is employed, not at that moment in that role, but in his occupation associated with law enforcement.
Yeah. I can't go into answering the questions because I did not specifically talk to the officers that put the handcuffs on, took them off. So it's hard to say. He did have a gunshot wound to him. It was a graze. Whether that played into the fact, I do not know. But bottom line, from my investigation, from the point it started, he was a subject of my investigation. At one point in time, early on in the investigation, we were looking at placing him in custody for the first-degree murder charge or investigation of first-degree murder based on information that he provided later in a statement, wound up changing that, and that was with consultation with the district attorney's office. We have a great partnership that works here in Denver where the DA's office hides or suspicious deaths. So we're in consultation with them from the beginning. After he made his statement and brought up the information he had, a choice was made at that point to continue with the investigation to see if we had information to corroborate more of what he's saying or if we found it to the opposite. And that was early in the investigation. But from the investigation get-go, from my side of the house, he was considered a suspect in this time. That were out there, it was a very chaotic and hectic scene. I was fairly close that day. I was at a volunteer project up on Holly, so I got there pretty quick. But my focus immediately went in towards the crime scene and such. I don't believe that he got special treatment, but that being took him off, so I can't answer that to any degree of certainty. I can tell you from the investigation once my team got involved. I think you had a question.
Can you talk about the Mongols members? You said the one that was critically injured was not very forthcoming. Overall, did you find that to be kind of a trend among the Mongols members?
We were able to identify anything else. We did work through the attorney that said he was representing them, Mr. Stubbs. I know came out here and held a